Ladies and gentlemen, fellow supporters, welcome to the riverfront tonight. We are very much Newport County AFC and very much united tonight. Thank you for coming along. This is possibly a momentous occasion for our football club, and we appreciate your support tonight. The Trust Board have been overwhelmed with the level of support, and we hope that we're going to help to achieve what I know we all want. We want to place on record our thanks for support to Les Scally, the current board of directors, Supporters Direct, who I'll introduce in a moment, and the Argus, and of course the Riverfront, and most importantly, yourselves. In terms of tonight, we will be passing over to James Maffey and Nick Igo from Supporters Direct, who's been guiding us through this difficult path at the moment, and they will cover the majority of the presentation. The running order will go through the presentation, and then there'll be a Q&A at the end, which I'm sure you'll all be interested in. We'll try to answer as many questions as we can, and we might not have all the answers, but if we can answer something, we will tell you if we're not in a position or whatever. We are under a confidentiality agreement, but we'll try to be as frank and as transparent as possible. I'd just like to introduce a couple of them. On my far left, I have Nick Igo from Supporters Direct, James Maffey. Now, the board of the Trust Board Committee at the moment consists of Sean Johnson, myself, John Bokett, Phil Sargent, Lisa Savage, unfortunately Tony, bring his hat to rush off because his girlfriend's not very well, rather suddenly, so he's obviously not here to his great disappointment. We have a few people that have gone on holiday tonight. As you can appreciate, the M4 is full and everybody's on their way on holiday, so that's where we're at. So if it's okay, I'd like to hand you over to James, who will commence the presentation.
Thank you very much. I can't actually see anyone. It's just like bright lights up here. I should have brought my sunnies. But thanks so much for Friday night coming out and an unbelievable turnout, really, which immediately shows me that there's a lot of people that care about their football club in this town. I already know that, of course, because I've been fortunate to be sharing about 100 emails a day with the Trust over the last couple of months, who have put in an incredible amount of effort and time, really just to see if there is interest, demand, and whether there's a viable chance that the club could be supporter-owned. So tonight I want to just talk a little bit about Supporters Direct, not too much because we're not the story here, but talk a bit about supporter ownership, some of the other clubs that are out there, what are the good points, what are the bad points, and hopefully just enlighten you a little bit on potentially what the club could look like as a supporter owned club. But before we get too excited, I'll also bring in consultant Nick Igo, who will go through a review that he's been undertaking to look at the finances. And I think we need to everyone to understand that it's still a huge challenge. We've got a hell of a lot of work to do if if we're going to get this outcome. And also, finally, just worth saying that at the end of the presentations, there's going to be Q&A, which often is where the best stuff happens anyway. So store up some questions, and I think we're here all evening. So hopefully we can get through as many of those as possible. You know, we want to make sure that everyone leaves tonight understanding what the possibilities of support ownership could be, but also making sure that everyone has asked the question they want to ask. And I'm sure some of the top table will be around afterwards if you'd rather ask some of us in a personal capacity as well. So very quickly, I'll just quickly run through Supporters Direct. We're not the sports chain store that sells football boots and sports gear in most town centres up and down the country. We were set up in 1999. Originally it was as a response really to the amount of money that was coming into English football. People thought that some clubs were getting a bit distanced from the community and the supporters that they support. And by setting up supporters trusts, so groups of supporters into, I suppose, a more organised, democratic formal body, that they'd be better placed to consult and add value to their football club. There's a very inspirational guy called Brian Lomax, who was the first ever supporter director of an English football club at Northampton Town in the early 90s. And people picked up on what had happened at Northampton Town, what Brian had done, and thought, you know, actually, this is a model that could work elsewhere. So we were formed in 1999, and there's now over 190 supporters trusts in the UK, from a real range of clubs, from Premier League clubs down to non-league clubs too. Just a few sort of headline figures. So these groups, over that time period, have collectively raised more than 40 million. Other countries and funders have picked up on what's going on here, and we now work across 23 European countries. Of course, there are some countries in Europe that are teaching us a fair bit about what member ownership or support ownership of football looks like. We work in other sports as well, which really is just using the same model of democratic ownership, which works just as well in rugby league and rugby union as it does in football. And just skipping to the last bit really, which is probably the most pertinent tonight, which is we've been lucky enough to help more than 40 clubs, different levels, so amateur, semi-professional and professional, into supporter ownership. Sure, quite how I move on, but I'll do that. Cool, okay. So just very quickly, this is, we have two technical, it's a Friday evening after all, but this is the definition that we work to as supporter ownership. You know, words like community and supporters and all this get mixed up quite a lot. But for us, it means that a minimum of 50% plus one, the club is controlled collectively by an entity which has got an open and inclusive membership. Membership works on a one member, one vote principle. Any profits that are made are reinvested back in the club, as opposed to being distributed to shareholders, which might raise a smirk because there aren't that many clubs that make big profits, but it's still, you know, a core principle of support ownership. And the club is committed to running as a sustainable business. And here are a load of badges of the clubs that we've worked with that are in the supporter ownership, just to give you a sense of the range, really. So people may or may not be aware, but so in the Football League at the moment, there's four clubs, which AFC Wimbledon, many of you know their story. Exeter City, who have both of these clubs have been in supporter ownership just over 10 years. Wickham Wanderers have been there about 3 years, and took over a club that was losing a lot of money, and still working to address that. And Portsmouth, many of you will know, that story very well. The supporters came together to collectively raise over £2 million through the supporters trust alongside some other money. And more locally, of course, I say locally, North Wales isn't particularly local, but Wrexham, you know, have done a fantastic job, certainly, in turning around a lot of the off-the-pitch stuff since they took over the club, including a debt where the club was effectively losing the best part of £1 million a year, and it turned a profit this year. And even more likely than that, Merthyr Town, not too far away. Okay, so again, some people here might be students of this sort of stuff, and others, you know, may not. So I'll just try and whip through some of these points so that people get a real feel for what support club might actually look like. So, as I said, open membership to people who support the objects of the club. You know, we want as many people as possible, if county is going to be supporter owned, to be members, to be actively involved, you know, to join each year, but hopefully volunteer and participate. It's one member, one vote. There'll be an annual membership renewal. We think this is really important, so that you get a membership who are going to be active and, you know, are keen and interested in what's going on at the club. You know, there's lots and lots of football clubs up and down the country where, you know, we see long lists of shareholders where, you know, people have bought shares and for the right reasons, no doubt, but, you know, 10, 20, 30 years on, they probably don't even know that they've got those shares, and sadly, some of them might have passed away. So we want to make sure, if possible, that the membership's renewed each year so that we've got an active membership. So able to raise money in a cost-effective way, that's something we'll come on to later. This is looking at whether community shares could be something that works here. It's a model which people might have heard of communities buying their local pub or local shop. It uses exactly the same legal structure, but just applies it to a sports club or a football club in this instance. Basically, because the entity is community owned and it exists for the benefit of the community, it doesn't have the same, doesn't operate in the same framework as a private company or a public company, I should say, where if they went out with a share offer, then it's about individual return and investment. So there's certain restrictions that are relaxed because it's a community benefit society, you know, which is a pro and also a con. In terms of, you know, something you don't have the same level of scrutiny over the offer and right to complain if things don't work out. So the governing board would be predominantly elected by the membership, and there will be an annual election for some of those positions, not all of them, but enough so there's continuity and new people coming on board. But it's not death by committee. There's a delegated authority that then passes to a smaller operational team or even just staff and volunteers themselves. You can almost imagine like an upturned pyramid where you've got the membership at the top who elect the board. The board work on behalf of the membership and report back to the membership on what how things are going. They then delegate, the board delegate authority down to people that make the day-to-day decisions. But as you can imagine, it's not a case of if you're a member, then you get consulted on literally every decision that's made. It's more about the broad direction of travel that's communicated. But if there are major decisions, then they're normally voted on by the membership. So for example, AFC Wimbledon, at the moment, they're looking at the potential of moving grounds. You know, that's the sort of decision that is, you know, going to be of huge significance if you're an AFC Wimbledon fan. So that's the sort of thing that they want to consult and make sure that the membership give their consent to, rather than just the board making that decision on their behalf. And then our club that spends what it earns with any profits reinvested. If there are assets, then there's protections within the rules that mean that those assets are protected. And ultimately, for us, we think a community benefit society is a legal structure that reflects what a club is and helps its profile. So, you know, if the club's not making money, then really, should it be a company? If we're saying that companies are ultimately designed to make shareholder wealth, and a football club, to me, feels like lots of people have a moral, feel a moral ownership for it, is this a more appropriate structure? Okay. So a nice equation for you for a Friday night, which is all potential, as I say. Like, it's not, as you can imagine, it's not just a silver bullet. It has to be worked out. But if the model goes well, we find that there's potential more support, there's potential more volunteering. We just done a study actually that looked at six different clubs that are supporter owned, and the majority of those clubs valued their volunteer time each year at over £100,000. So you've got two non-league clubs in particular who are over £150,000, which was based on the number of volunteer hours that people put in, just paying them at the minimum wage. What did that equate to? So we find that the model appeals to more people, that they're willing to put more time into it. And of course, trying to find, work that into what is a professional football club is a challenge in itself, but it can unlock more skills to help. Sponsorship, again, it's another potential selling point that people or organisations and businesses are willing to sponsor the club, because they feel, you know, that it's owned by the community, and that, you know, the money that the club makes will all go back into the club. Stronger partnerships, again, it's really about how you're set up. We find that particularly local authorities, but some of the local organisations as well, feel like they can engage in a slightly different way because of the legal structure of the club and what it stands for and its commitment to the community. If you get the governance structure right, which we're going to hear from the guys a bit more about, then you've got greater transparency and trust, hopefully. There's potential for more funding opportunities because of that legal structure as well. Fortunately, not for the playing budget, as you can imagine, but some of the other off-field stuff. Better cost control. You've got lots of people that have got an eye on what is going on and understand more about what the budget should be. Then that potentially can all add up to greater income and reduced costs, which can feed in, if you wanted to spend your money in that place, into a third budget. Nick's going to talk a little bit more about the benchmarking and some of the financial information of your competitors. So it's worth bearing this in mind, that these are all potential upsides that we might be able to compete against some of the rivals. Okay? Don't know if you can really see that slide. It's just trying to give an idea of typically how the route to support ownership. So we're at the far left, well, possibly halfway through left and the middle at the same time. So this is how, you know, we've worked with the likes of Portsmouth, Wrexham, and other clubs to get to supporter ownership. It's obviously really important that ultimately the supporters and the community actually want the outcome in the first place, and this process tonight hopefully is part of that. And I know the guys have been very busy speaking to various people to talk to them about support ownership. You know, we need to make sure that people are up for it, otherwise it's just not going to work. And if we can get people bought into it, then how do we utilise that goodwill resource? The middle bit is obviously absolutely fundamental. You know, as the guys here completely agree with, we're certainly not going to suggest moving forward with anything if you know, the amount that we need to raise or the, you know, the financial position of the club is too unworkable, that we don't think that there's going to be an offer that we can put out. You know, ultimately, it's a big responsibility when it comes to money, and if we're going to talk about asking people to invest more money than they already invest at the club, then we need to make sure that we fully understand what the financial position is and what the club would look like on the other side if it is going to be run at a break-even basis. So this is obviously an important part. We want to make sure that any of the debt or historic the liabilities can be negotiated as best as possible so that we can put out an offer which is achievable and is going to raise the most amount of money to give the supporters not just to get the club but also to give some working capital so that there's a potential of a decent season or two to start under supporter ownership. History of Supporters Direct, I should say, often a lot of clubs we work with are in financial crisis, so it's not always the case, but you know, there's often very difficult circumstances where things need to be turned around really quickly. I think that is an issue here, but by the same token, there's good lines of communication and good discussion that's gone on, which means that we can try and work through in a more orderly and kind of professional manner to make sure that we put out a proper share offer. When the share offer comes out, the share offer, for me, will try and answer every question that's out there. You know, we're going to as much detail as we possibly can, as I said, because if we're asking people to invest their money in it, it has to be completely open. So it will explain the structure of support ownership. It will explain what we think the budget is. It will explain where the money's going to go. It should answer everything. That's the point, you know. Until we get all those answers, we can't launch the offer. And the final part at the end then, the holy grail, as it were. So the money, I should say, if we get to the point of a share offer, would all sit in a holding account. And if we don't raise the target, there's not enough interest, then the money would come back to the individuals. So there's no risk, it all sits in that holding account. Nothing can happen to that money unless the target is reached. If we reach the target, then that money would be converted into shares. We use the trust model. It's the best structure for us, as I said, to be for supporter ownership. It's got that democratic structure. It's got the ability to offer these community shares. So individuals would invest money. They would hold shares in the trust. You wouldn't get more membership, more voting rights. So you join as a member, and then there's a separate class of share, which is called the community share. Those shares will be held personally by each individual investor, and there's a potential in the future to withdraw that money. It's all subject to the club ultimately having the funds to do so and the board agreeing that. But they are potentially withdrawable. They can pay a small amount of interest, so it's dividend, but it's capped at a very low level so that almost all the money stays within the club. And there's a possibility to add other benefits to those shares as well, if that's what people want. But as I say, at the moment, if we get to the share offer point, the money is just going to be on deposit. It only moves across to shares if we reach the target. Okay, that's enough waffle from me. I'm going to pass over to Nick, who's going to talk through some of his work.